Now, the title of my talk is General Relativity, a Case Study in Numerology. Now, I mean that both facetiously and literally, because I'm going to show you today, using mathematics and numbers, that general relativity and all its associated things, such as black holes and big bangs, are really nothing other than some kind of numerology. But that's exactly what the black hole event horizon has. In fact, they tell us that the black hole event horizon, the escape velocity or the escape speed of a black hole at the event horizon is the speed of light. That's why nothing can escape. Really? If light is traveling at the speed of light and that's the escape speed, wouldn't you expect light to escape? I would.
I'm a sociologist of science, and I'm here at this conference as a sociologist of science. And as a sociologist in general, I'm interested in social groups and collectivities and communities. And so as a sociologist of science, I'm interested in scientific communities. And so I'm interested in you. Now, I suggested this was a change of subject matter for me, and that's true, but it's also misleading, because sociology, as I've said, is the study of social groups, of communities, of collaboration, of collectively held knowledge, of shared values, of the way in which communities mobilize to maintain and defend their boundaries, of the social determination of what is acceptable and what's unacceptable. And so these are topics common to pretty much any sociology, including the sociology of science.
Something happens very similar to this party example to the chemical elements on the sun, and a certain group of elements are much more likely to be found outside the sun than on the surface of the sun. So for example, on the photosphere, we see about 35 magnesium atoms for every million hydrogen atoms. But in the solar wind leaving the sun, there are four times that many magnesium atoms. Another example, we see about 47 iron atoms for every million hydrogen atoms on the photosphere. But a solar flare might have 100 times that much iron.
So you come and you take a look at a satellite image of a hurricane on Earth. And you guys can do this, just pop on Google and type in hurricane. You're going to see the eye, just like the umbra on the sunspot. You're going to see the swirling clouds that we've all come to know in a hurricane, just like you would see in the corona on the sun. But if you get to look at one of the new rapid scan images that GOES is taking of the weather, or you take a look at some of the hurricane or typhoon images on NOAA's Environmental Visualization Lab, you will see that amidst those swirling clouds, you can see lines.
That's about one quarter of the story. And it seems strange that they stopped there. Stig Lundquist, who did this model before me, about 50 years before I got there, he'd stopped there. Even good old Hannes Alfvén, where you ask him to draw a picture of a Birkeland current, he'd draw something that looks like that. That's a very incomplete picture, because you can just think of being continuing on. Go out to the next little distance out from the center of this. What do you think happens? Nothing?
The lure of what we think we know, the comfort of the accepted wisdom versus the fear of not knowing. We have to recognize that this love of certainty is a very, very innate and undeniable human attribute. It would be disingenuous, if not foolhardy, to propose that there's some group of humans somewhere, somehow, that are somehow immune to or above this love of certainty. It's an integral component of our collective psyche.
They have now shown that the neutrino has mass. Now, the very idea that it didn't have mass meant that it couldn't have been a real particle anyway, because there was no such thing as a particle with no mass. The problem then was that, according to the standard particle or standard model of subatomic particles, the neutrino doesn't interact with the Higgs field, as it's called. That meant that there was something seriously wrong with the standard model. So what has happened? They've said, This gives us the opportunity to modify the standard model. In other words, please send more money.
It's all moving, right? Nothing ever stops moving. A gust of wind and a cosmic jet are manifesting a single power. That's the world we're given. The objection to perpetual motion machines is one of those absurd capitalist parsimonies. It is no free lunch. It comes from a mindset, a metaphysics, that privileges neutrality, stability, equilibrium. But what the world gives us as facts are polarization, unstable equilibria, and explosions. This world is in perpetual motion.
But of course, you don't always have to stay in that position. You become a tenured professor at some point, and you can push out and innovate. And if that were not the case, there'd be no new science. So somehow it does happen that new science does get developed. People that are radicals in their field are able to do something about their radicalness. They are able to take bold steps.
There's not just rigor in the choice of statistics, not just rigor in the kinds of designs that we use. It's not just rigor even in the language of how we write about interpretations and alternative explanations and limitations of experimental design in formal scientific papers that we write. We are told to stick closely to the data and not let our emotions or even our humor get in the way.
And that, I think, is the single biggest problem in physics today, is that we worship the discipline of mathematics as science, and it's not. It's an important adjunct and a tool. It's a kind of shorthand describing what we observe, and then you can manipulate the symbols to try and get more information from that data. But it's rather like handing over the control of a company to the typing pool, the shorthand readers. Very few people can read shorthand, very few people can read all of those mathematical runes on the blackboards. In fact, it's become the cliche for genius.
So we accept its breakthrough one crack in the door at a time. It is working if you actually follow what's going on as our communication with real scientists, feet on the ground researchers. You'll see that. Give us a hearing personally, give us an opportunity to just engage you on the basis of fact and implications of fact. The EU material is very persuasive with people.